First of all, I want to welcome everyone. It is so good to see once again what I call the best in education. Students, staff members, ACPS officials, community members, city government, our Congressman Jim Moran, and administrators from our school, all here to celebrate something very good. Let me tell you how I first found out about Ben Carson. This is why it's so special to me and why we have persevered against some odds, haven't we, Roy? When I was teaching at Laurel High School, one of my colleagues and also a neighbor had a daughter who was 6 years old, I think, when this happened. She caught some kind of virus that attacked her brain. And what the virus did was to actually put holes in the brain, and they thought the girl was going to die because they'd taken her to every doctor around and couldn't find anybody to help her. In desperation, they took her to Johns Hopkins Hospital, and there she met Dr. Ben Carson. Dr. Ben Carson saved that young lady's life. And ever since then, I've been fascinated with Ben Carson, and I then went and read his books. I'm amazed at the exceptional doctoring skills that Ben Carson has, but for him to then give back so much to the community in the way of his foundation, I think is especially extraordinary. You would think that just saving people's lives would be enough. This man goes above and beyond to help kids. Roy and his lovely wife took me to their gala last year. It was incredibly well done. It was a wonderful evening, and they had us hooked. And it has not been easy, as they'll tell us, because we are, once again, pioneers. This is the first time they've had a reading room in a high school, so it really wasn't easy to do this. But because of Chris Gutierrez and Michelle Grayson's perseverance and absolute unwillingness to say no, this thing is happening. And I can't... And I can't personally thank Chris and Michelle, two of our teachers here at TC, and Roy and his wonderful wife for making this happen. This is a very, very special day. So I want to welcome all of you and tell you this today is what makes TC Williams High School, Alexandria City Public Schools, and the City of Alexandria so special. Thank you all for being here. And now I'm very pleased to present to you someone that I greatly admire, our Congressman Jim Moran.
Boy, just such a wonderful principal of TC, and it is not an easy job. And I mean, what a gem we had in John Porter. Nobody ever thought that anybody could succeed John, but Suzanne has. And you know, students come here, and she knows them by name, and they know she loves them and what they're. And all the potential contained within them. So Suzanne, thank you for just being such a wonderful leader in the education of our community. This is an exciting day. This can be world-changing for the inner world of our students, our young people. Even if only one young person is able to transform their lives by the ability to find that refuge where they can sit and learn about the world around them outside of the influence of their peers and their neighborhood and develop the kind of intellectual curiosity that enables them to fulfill their potential in later life. It's worth it. But there's going to be so many students. I suspect we're going to have to expand this. I'm looking at some of the lobby there, maybe, you know, Mort, but, you know, because this is what education is all about. It's not just the academic courses. It's not even the superb teachers and administrators. It's opening up a different world, a duco out of the world in which we live to find another world in which that we want to experience. I've met Ben Carson. I can't say he's a friend because when I met him, I was so excited. I couldn't even get one word after another, Roy. You know, he and Paul Farmer and a handful of other people are quietly changing the world. He's a great man, brilliant. You know, there are tens of thousands of young people whose lives have been saved because of his brilliance applied to the field of medicine. And now he's applying it to providing a complementary learning opportunity for our young people. And, you know, TC, this is the first school in 2012. The other schools are going to be coming here, seeing how it works. And we're going to get it around the country. And let me just quickly before, because I know you want to hear from the superintendent and from Mayor Bill Yule and the other speakers. But, you know, when I was growing up in high school, I would finish my paper route early, thinking about what I was going to do afterwards. And on Saturdays, we didn't have football practice, and I'd sneak down to the library. And they used to have these We Were There books and these Claire B. sports books inside. All of you is too young to even know who I'm talking about. But they, you know, it opened up a whole different world. And I didn't have, you know, my jock friends who was, oh, what are you reading? You don't know. I could just be by myself and dream about what I might be able to become and actually experience the things that you can find only in books and now in the technology that makes it so much easier to find out the contents of books. And it changed my life. That's what this facility, this institution, and what really our community is all about, changing the lives of our young people so they can become all they were meant to be. And that's what this room is all about. Thank you all for being here and for supporting such an important initiative at TC. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Congressman. I understand you're running over to the halls of Congress to say a few choice words about moving the Congress ahead. While you're there, can you put in a few good words about some more money for education? For reading? What do you think? We thank you, Congressman, for your support. Take care, Jim. Yeah, I woke up this morning thinking, gosh, I'm tired. I had a board meeting last night, which is always a wonderful thing to have, Ms. Gorsuch. But had a very late board meeting, got home late, didn't get to have time with my family, didn't get to have time thinking about all the wonderful things that we can rejoice about in life. And then I remembered, today is the grand opening of the Ben Carson Reading Room. And I said, what better thing to rejoice about than reading and children and all good things that go with that. So I am absolutely delighted to be here as part of this grand opening today. And I want to give you a sense of how this started. Even preceding the little story that our principal, Mrs. Maxey, shared with us, two very good-looking young men, not so young, but very good-looking, came to see me one afternoon in my office and said, we have this dream, we have this idea that it would be terrific if we made a connection, a partnership with the work that Dr. Carson does and with the Alexandria City Public Schools. And from that casual, easy conversation emerged this amazing day and this amazing opportunity. I think we would be remiss, I understand all the hard work Chris did, I understand all of that, if we didn't thank those two people who actually started this dream for Alexandria, Dr. Heron and Mayor Yule. Would you please stand up and accept our gratitude? We greatly appreciate that. You know, when you go around schools, not just here in Alexandria, but across the country, you see that poster that says, reading is fundamental. You know that sign? And we pass by, and usually there are celebrities who are reading some book, sitting in a chair, and thinking and saying something pithy and cute and wonderful about how important reading is. I have a different dream about a poster like that. Wouldn't it be great to take all those celebrities' pictures out of the posters and put our students' faces in those posters and saying, not only is reading fundamental, it is terrific. It has shaped my life. It has helped make me who I am. So I extend a challenge to all of us here to create our own ACPS. Reading is fundamental, and let it evolve and come out of the great work out of the Carson Reading Room. When I first talked to Dr. Heron and Mary Yule about this project, it was in the context of thinking big. It was in the context of dreaming. Reading, for many of us in life, has done that. It has helped shape who we are. I can remember reading a book in eighth grade, a book called Johnny Tremaine, which is no longer part of our curriculum. And I sat there reading this book at the end of the day, because we had homeroom in eighth grade in Allentown, Pennsylvania, at the end of the day. And I looked up, and all my classmates were gone. But my teacher let me sit there and read, not to embarrass me or anybody else around there. And I got so wrapped up in that story, I lost all sense of the world around me. And from that moment, I knew that words were an important part of my life and understood that dreaming was not just understanding what we read in biology texts or math texts or social studies texts to understand who we are and how we came here, but it introduces us to people that help us dream, help us be inspired about what can be. And when I look at that picture of Ben Carson, I can't think of a better person in this city, in this part of the country, to inspire us, to help shape our lives, and to dream with us about what could be in life. So I am absolutely delighted, pleased beyond words, in this setting, where right over here we also have the Fred Day Commons, where we take some of the true icons of our communities and blend them into something very special for the students of Alexandria. There are some people here today that I'd like to introduce who have been very supportive of this project, who behind the scenes have nudged and encouraged and said, keep going. And so allow me to introduce, first of all, the chair of our school board, Ms. Cheryl Gorsuch. I've already introduced you to Mayor Yule, who truly was one of the founding fathers of this project, and Dr. Heron, we thank you as a even more behind the scenes, but yet inspirational founding father. Senator Warner's representative is here, Marvin Fergo. Is he here, I hope? Over there. Thank you for being here representing Senator Warner. We also have Tim Kaine, representative, Gwen Sigda. Gwen, you're right there. Thank you for being here on behalf of Tim Kaine. Mrs. Carson is here? No. There you are. Mrs. Carson is here. Please stand up. Let them see you. We understand Dr. Carson is in surgery this morning. Is that Friday? He has clinic today. He has another job besides inspiring and dreaming. I want to thank all of you for being part of this project, for being here today. There are two others, even more important than all of us, with great humility. We have two Carson scholars who are here. The first, Abby Bolton. Abby, where is Abby? She's down the hall. She was at the reception desk when you came in, that beautiful young woman, that's Abby. And it is my pleasure to introduce Samuel Davies, who is going to greet us as well. Samuel, come on up, Samuel. Samuel is a Carson scholar, one of our outstanding students here at TC. I had the good fortune to first meet him when another wonderful project, when another wonderful project, because of the great work of Dr. Heron and Ben Carson, was revealed in the spring. Because of your great work, 24,000 books were contributed to the Alexandria City Public School children. And at that time, I first got to meet you, and I was impressed then, and I'm even more impressed now. But I do want you all to say hello to Abby and to greet her. Good morning. And now it's my pleasure to introduce to you a Carson scholar, Samuel.
Good morning, all. My name is Samuel Davies, and I am a 2011 Carson Scholar. Some of you might be wondering what a Carson Scholar is. Permit me to give you a brief introduction of the Ben Carson Scholarship Fund, and then you will know. In 1994, Dr. Benjamin Carson, the world-renowned Johns Hopkins pediatric neurosurgeon, and his wife, Mrs. Candy Carson, read a research study about education in the United States. They were alarmed by the findings. The study showed that our nation's students ranked 21 out of 22 countries, next to the bottom of the list in science and math. Furthermore, they observed that many school display cases were filled with large trophies paying tribute to their sports team's achievements, while honor students only received a pin or a certificate. So they were compelled to take action. They believed that if children could be taught early to excel, they would stay motivated and have a higher chance of educational success later in life. Therefore, the Carson Scholars Fund was built on these principles. Carson scholarships are awarded to students in grades 4 through 11 who exemplify academic excellence and humanitarian qualities. Winners receive a $1,000 scholarship to be invested towards their college education, along with a recognition package and an invitation to attend an awards banquet. Carson scholars become role models and leaders at their schools. I am proud to say that I am one of the first two recipients of this most prestigious scholarship at T.C. Williams High School. It is an honor and a responsibility that I take very seriously. With support and the mentoring of the Carson Scholars Fund, I know I will be successful in my life. At this juncture, I would like to introduce the next speaker for this auspicious event. I was privileged to meet with him in May of 2011 at the Jefferson Houston School when Duffy Books presented 24,000 books to Alexandria City Public Schools. I can attest to this that he is indeed an advocate for education. A native of Alexandria, he graduated from Quinnipiac University in 1972, and he was on the Alexandria School Board from 1974 to 1984, and on the Alexandria City Council from 1994 until 2003, when he was elected Alexandria's first African-American mayor. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming the Honorable William Yule.
Thank you very much for that kind introduction. Everything he said was perfect except for one thing that he forgot to mention. I am a Titan. I graduated from T.C. Williams in 1968. I'm not shameful about that. Just a few years ago. But honored to be here this morning to participate in such an important program. It's a historic day at T.C. Williams High School. It's an historic day in the city of Alexandria for a historic purpose, and that is to dedicate the reading room, not only to dedicate the reading room, but as you have so witnessed, to honor two of the first two Ben Scholars here in the city of Alexandria. And so it's a proud moment, but before I get started, let me also introduce two other folks who are with us. And if other members of City Council have arrived, just let me know, but I know we have City Councilwoman Del Pepper present. And we also have the City of Alexandria's librarian, Rose Dawson. Rose, welcome. Want to also thank Superintendent Sherman and the Alexandria City Public Schools for believing in what Roy and I and his wife and Dr. Ben Carson and his wife, the initiative that we brought forth. And initially it looked like it was here, there, everywhere, but finally we were convincing enough that this was very important and it had legs, and the superintendent agreed to move it forward. So we say thank you. I want to say thanks and congratulations again to Abby Colton and Samuel Davies for, again, being the scholar recipients here at T.C. Williams. Also want to thank Dr. Ben Carson for his dedication and commitment to youth all across this great country. I had the opportunity about a little more than a year and a half ago to meet Dr. Ben Carson. While have heard a lot about him and read a lot about him for many, many years, I got to meet him through my friend Dr. Roy Heron. And that happened simply because Roy had a beautiful fiance And they wanted to get married, and they approached me and asked me if I would conduct their wedding. And I said, sure, of course I'd do their wedding. They wanted to do it here in the historic city of Alexandria, at Gatsby's Tavern, and so forth. And lo and behold, at the wedding, I got to meet the infamous Dr. Ben Carson and his lovely wife, Candy. And so that's the relationship that I have with the Carsons. But knowing full well that Dr. Ben Carson is a world-renowned brain surgeon who is involved in repairing the mind. But more so, and more important, something that he came to realize, that in the process of repairing the mind, you're also helping folks to become visionaries, to be able to think on their own again and to make a difference. And so all the more reason why he created the foundation. But then Barbara and Roy being a medical, outstanding, renowned medical doctor here in the Washington, D.C. metropolitan area. As a doctor, he's a healer. And part of what he's responsible for doing is helping people heal their bodies to become much more healthier. And in the process of healing your body, you're also creating a healthy mind. And so the partnership, the collaboration between these two outstanding physicians is just outstanding because they appreciate where they came from and the challenges they had to encounter to be where they are today, to recognize that just, you know, we have these talents, we have these skills, we're making a lot of money, but you know what, it doesn't mean a hill of beans if we don't help give back to help make a difference in the lives of a lot of other folks, particularly young people. And so that's what this is all about. So I want to thank Roy and Dr. Carson for what they've done and what they will continue to do. But more importantly, this is an important day simply. I also want to thank Verizon as one of the major corporate sponsors for this event. And Verizon, as we all know, is they create and offer the ability to communicate. And so when you're talking about reading, reading has to have that wavelength, that connectivity to the brain so that you can comprehend and understand. And so Verizon is very important in that regard. But also, end with my comments, as we begin to celebrate Dr. Martin Luther King's Jr.'s birthday this coming weekend, and then particularly on Monday, January 16th, the federal holiday, let us not forget what Dr. King stood for and so forth. Let's be inspired. Let's be responsible, but more importantly, let us all work to keep the dream alive. And that's what these young scholars are going to do. They're the ones that are going to be the future. They're the ones that are going to help make a difference and give back to our society. So again, thank you and congratulations.
Well, let me just say, this is one word, wow. That's the only thing I can say. When I came in here today, I'm pumped up. Everybody. This has been a mission of mine, and I met with my good friend, Bill Ewell, I've known for many years. I told him I wanted to be a spark for the community. One person can't do anything by themselves, but I said, I want to be a spark, and hopefully the spark will then energize the community to come forward and help our kids. And you today are seeing what it did. And I congratulate everybody who has come together and helped me, and could not have done it without the people who they've already mentioned here, just amazing, from the superintendent of schools, Suzanne Massey, I love you, and all the team you put together. And this is going to be a model for all the schools throughout the country. So TC is going to now be, once again, recognized as a trail setter for the country. And it's because of all the hard work that the staff here and everyone has done, and you've got this place absolutely gorgeous, and the room is beautiful. Everything is here. And I want to say also, when I had that meeting, I had a vision, and I said, I'm going to start and hope it works out. I started off by the two scholars you met. I financed and gave them those scholarships myself, and hoping that would be a start. But I said I want to be a spark. 3 weeks after I had the meeting, I get a call on a Sunday from a gentleman I had never known. And he said he was vice president of Verizon. He heard about me. And he wanted to learn about what our mission was and that he was going to see what kind of organization we were. Well, that man here is here. You're going to hear from him a little bit later. I owe a lot to him because he has brought Verizon into it. This is just a partnership that's going to be so magnificent for not just TC, but the entire community. And so I do take my hat off and thank Verizon and BK Fullerton for being the visionary to help us. Now that spark is already lit, I now want to be a flame torch. So what it means is it's not going to just stop here. I want you to know that all right now we have 10 schools that we are awarding scholarships to in this area. They'll get their scholarships in April. I'm also going to make a commitment to double that every year. So I want to go to 20 schools, then 40, okay? I also want to take this reading room and duplicate it, and I want to have at least one and hopefully two reading rooms a year that we're going to open up also. But to do that, I'm going to need some people to help me. So I'm going to ask those of you who are here, who are motivated and have a desire, as I have a passion and we all do, for our kids, to consider volunteering or at least communicating with us. Let us know what organizations or corporations that you may know or have contact with that has also the similar vision. We already have the model here. We can expand it if you will help us. So please consider, I'll give my phone number, 703-629-8996. I gotta plug it, I gotta get some help. But the main thing is truly, we love our kids. And this is the most important day I can say now in my life. Thank you very much for everything. And I want to say one last thing. I would be remiss if I didn't say that this all happened with God. God brought all of us together, and he continued to open doors for me, and I'm only a vehicle. And my lovely wife has been a big supporter also of me, so. And I'm going to ask that we continue this endeavorment because my territory, my obligation is the entire Northern Virginia area, all of the city of D.C., and the five-mile radius of the Beltway in Maryland. So I want to try to put a Carson Scholar in every school from the fourth grade on up. But I need your help. So please join us, and this will happen. Again, thank you also, Bill Ewell, for starting this, because he's the first person I sat down and talked to, and he said, I'm going to make this happen. So thank you again. We're now going to hear from one of the sophomores here at TC. Is it Devera Brown, I think?
Good morning. I am De'Ara Brown. I am a sophomore at TC Williams. In our class, we read about Dr. Carson and watched a movie about his life. I would like to read something from one of Dr. Carson's books, Gifted Hands. That was very meaningful to me. Mother had already decided how we would spend our free time. We weren't watching television. You boys are going to go to the library and read two books. At the end of each week, you will give me a report on what you've read. That rule sounded impossible. Two books? I never read a whole book in my life, except those they made us read in school. I couldn't believe I could ever finish a whole book in a short week. But a day or two later, found Curtis and me dragging our feet 7 blocks from home to the public library. We grumbled and complained, making the journey seem endless. But Mother has spoken, and it didn't occur to either of us to disobey. The reason? We respected her. We knew she meant business and knew we better mind. But most important, we loved her. Benny, she said again and again, if you can read, honey, you can learn just about anything you want to know. The doors of the world are open to people who can read. And my boys are going to be successful in life because they're going to be the best readers in the school. As I think about it, I am convinced today, as I was back in fifth grade, that my mother meant that. She believed in Curtis and me, and she had such faith in us. We didn't dare fail. Her unbound confidence nudged me into starting to believe in myself. I understand why Ben Carson's mother insisted on her boys working so hard. She wanted her children to be successful in life. She knew they were capable of great things. Ben Carson's mother believed in him and would not allow him to waste his time or his potential. Because of this influence, he is now Dr. Carson, with a beautiful wife and children. Reading this story makes me think of my own mother, who pushes me to do my best. She would not let me get lazy and constantly stretch myself to take honors classes and go to college. One day, I will be successful as Dr. Carson. Now, I would like to introduce another Titan, Raquel Carrington.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming here to share this exciting day. As the era said, my name is Rockwell Carrington, and I am a junior at TC Williams. I'm getting close to graduation and moving on to college. I'm really looking forward to the Ben Carson Reading Room because it will give us a quiet and relaxing place to read whatever we choose, and it will give us a chance to use incredible technology such as iPads, Kindles, and smart books. I would like to share a short passage from another one of Dr. Carson's books called Think Big. It focuses on Dr. Carson's philosophy that encourages people of all ages to maximize their own potentials and help others. There is no such person as a self-made individual. Some might dispute that, but I argue from my own experience. Truth, I come from a poor, single-parent family, and my mother worked 10 to 15 hours every day to keep us off welfare. Although at one time we had to rely on food stamps. By fifth grade, no one challenged my position at the bottom of my class. As we also learned, my eyesight was so poor that I couldn't see the teacher from the back of the room until I received an eye examination and glasses. However, I did not know how poor my eyesight was. My list could go on, but I think I proved my point about my beginnings. As indicated in my previous chapter and in my earlier book, Gifted Hands, I've come a long way, but I ain't do it by myself. Throughout my life, at various times, specific individuals have touched my life and enabled me to climb from the bottom of my class to the top of my professions. I could not have done it without such special people. I can relate to this passage because I was that same kind of fifth grader not so long ago. What made the difference for me was that I was encouraged and motivated to want to do better and want more out of life. One person who opened my eyes and helped me realize that life isn't a game was my uncle. He taught me a lot out of his own personal experiences. He said that his life would have been a lot better if he had had one special person to guide him throughout his life. Like Dr. Carson, my mother always been there for me and let me know that she has high hopes and expectations for me. Other people who love me have also encouraged me. With the help of all these people, instead of selling drugs or someone cleaning bathroom floors, I will be a boss, managing my own business and giving back to the people that need me. What I'm trying to say is that everybody has the potential to be successful in life instead of throwing away a free education that some kids in different countries will die for. Special people who believe in you make success more possible. And now, it is my honor and pleasure to introduce Dr. Carson's extraordinary wife, Mrs. Candy Carson.
Good morning, everyone. It's really exciting to be here, having our first reading room in a high school. It's just nothing we've ever done before, so it's exciting in that way. And the first one in Virginia is just, there's a lot of exciting things going on. But before I say anything else, I want to again thank all of the people that are responsible for it being here. You know, the principal, the superintendent, Roy and Mayor Yule, and BK Fulton from Verizon. You've all done a stellar job. Looking forward to seeing it because I know it's going to be spectacular. and it's the first one with technology in it, so you guys are going to have a great time. I want to talk to the kids for a little bit. The kids back there, right? Okay, good. Do you ever get bored? Raise your hands. Anybody gets bored? Oh, boy. Okay. You know you don't have to be. You can put your hands down. You know why you don't have to be bored, right? Please, somebody. Okay. In a book, you can go anywhere. You can go to Mars. You can go, you can shrink to the size of, so that you fit in a drop of water, and then go through the body and see all of the blood vessels and all that kind of stuff. I mean, you can go be Batman. You can go to Disney World. You can go to South Africa. You can go anywhere you ever imagine, and someplace you didn't even imagine, if you have a book. So you never have to be bored. And the thing is, when you're reading a book, think about this, how it works your brain. Because when you look at the words, your brain is forming those letters into words, and then when you read a sentence, you know, you're developing your syntax, which is your understanding, you know, making things flow well in a sentence, and it helps you to learn how to express yourself better at job interviews and everything else. When you're trying to rap, you know, to, you know, cute one over there or the handsome one over there, it's also it opens so many doors, so many opportunities. That's why we do the reading rooms. And that's what happened with my husband. I mean, when he was at the bottom of his class and he started reading, of course, all kinds of opportunities opened up. I mean, he became the city executive officer for the ROTC because of his reading. Because he started late and then he became the city, he was the top kid in the ROTC in the whole city of Detroit. So just to let you know, it's really not something you should neglect. It's something that you should really focus on because it really develops you to the point where you can be anything you want to be. Another thing about being a neurosurgeon's wife, you hear all these statistics, you realize you've got, each one of you has 14 billion, with a B, cells and connections in your brain. That's 14 times 1,000 million, okay? You've got all of these cells in there that can do all kinds of things, and I wish I could recite the neural pathways like my husband does, where he talks about when you raise your hand and how, you know, the sound waves in your external auditory meatus, they impinge upon your tympanic membrane and set up a vibratory force, and it goes through you know, all of this stuff, and it takes him about, his best time is 43 seconds. But anyway, all these things happen when you raise your hand, you know, and if you can do that, not even think about it, there's so many things that you can do. Just don't let anybody tell you you can't, because with all of this brain power in here, you can. If they say you can't, you can smile and acknowledge what they said. You might not want to be rude and say, you know, actually say you can't. But the thing is, you can, and a lot of times, say you miss a day in school here or there and so on and so forth, you might be missing one of those building blocks that makes everything work. You know, readings. Not hard, and math isn't hard either. How many people think math is hard? Okay. But you know what makes it easy? What you've got different principles that build on each other, okay? So if you know the principles in the beginning, then everything else builds on that. Thing about reading. Say you knew 20 of the letters. You knew most of them, but you didn't know all of them. And you knew everything but A, E, S, T, E, and O. What could you read? Yeah, so if you fill in those holes in your education, you can go back and develop and be the best that you can be. So with those thoughts in mind, please use our reading room, develop yourselves, because you can be whatever you want to be. Now I'd like to introduce he's become a dear friend, B.K. Fulton, who's with Verizon. He's a guy who, you know, he started out like the rest of us, but he got a computer engineering degree, and then he went on to urban affairs and architecture, got a master's in science, and then got a JD law degree, okay? So to prepare him for what he's doing now, he's the vice president, one of the vice presidents at Verizon and in Virginia, and he leads a team. I have to make sure I say it right. He leads a team that ensures that the business environment for the company allows it to be practical. So
the company would not be practical without this guy. He's a good guy. Let's give him a hand.
And profitable. Can you hear me now? Had to do that. I think Roy, among others, said it best. Wow. I remember, not too long ago, we were at your house having dinner with Dr. Carson, Candy, Barbara, and we were talking about the possibility of this. And you all did it. It's real. It's here. I'm humbled by this. You know, over 100 years ago, someone sat around and said, I think we can get people to communicate with each other without leaving home through a wire. And they invented this. It's a candlestick phone. It's over 100 years old. Someone believed they could talk to someone who wasn't there. Someone invested in it, and they made it so. Less than 4 years, less than 4 years ago, someone said, well, we can get rid of the wires, and I want my camera, my stereo, a little internet, and some really cool applications. And they did it. That's right, your iPhone. Today, I carry my movies, books, and my office on this iPad connected to a cool keyboard. All of a sudden, I've got a very light laptop that I can carry anywhere. It's my office. So whenever I'm traveling, I have everything I need with me. This is the technology that's in your reading rooms. It's serious stuff. Everyone that's come before you today believes in you. That's why Verizon made its investments, and on behalf of Verizon and the Verizon Foundation, we're honored to partner with you. But everybody here, everybody believes in you. That's why we're here. That's why we did this. Think big, T.C. Williams. Think big. Thank you. And next up is Marvin Figueroa from Senator Warner's office. Marvin.
Good morning. Make sure I'm not too loud. My name is Marvin Figueroa, and I am Senator Mark Warner's healthcare and education legislative aide. So that means I advise the senator on healthcare and education. The senator wanted to be here personally today, but he is right now in India. And he's having conversations and trying to establish some partnerships with Indian officials that will help us bring back American jobs. That's one of his biggest priorities. But he wanted to send me here today to say that he is incredibly proud of the work that's going on at T.C. Williams, and that every day that he thinks about it is what motivates him to continue working those long, frustrating hours on behalf of the folks, the good folks here and in the Commonwealth in general. I just want to be really brief, but I want to say that this school is very encouraging to me as well. I've only been here for about 5-10 minutes, and I went to the entrepreneurship room, and I had a conversation with folks about what they wanted to do after they graduated from here. And they were telling me their college plans. They were telling me they wanted to major in marketing, they wanted to major in political science, they wanted to go to Japan, they wanted to go to Australia and study biophysics. I don't even know what that is. And it felt good to me because I was born in Honduras and immigrated to this country when I was 5 years old, and we immigrated to New York City. And I went to schools that were failing. They weren't doing a good job. And it's encouraging to see that this school has decided that they're gonna do better, that they're gonna focus all the attention on improving student outcomes, that they're gonna make the tough choices to make sure that the future of Virginia is brighter than the present. And I'm just so proud to be here. I'm so proud of you all, and the Senator sends his greetings. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Chris Gutierrez, and I'm the chair of the reading room. On the back of your program are our thanks to so many people who helped us And I'm not going to take the time to go through, but everybody who's listed there has been absolutely fabulous. But I do want to embarrass one person, and that's my co-chair, Michelle Grayson. Is she here or is she hiding? She's hiding. But anyway, oh, there she is in the back, waving her arms wildly. Yeah. And I want to thank you all for taking the time in your day to come and join us. But I think we should get on to see our reading rooms. Before that, we have some gifts of appreciation for several of our guest speakers. You can't come to T.C. Williams and leave without several things. One is our tie-dye Titan t-shirt. Another is a wonderful book that our students wrote, We Are the Titans, with bios of kids that have gone through this school. And suitable for the back window of your car is a Titan decal. So Mrs. Carson, BK, and Dr. Heron, I expect to see you wearing your matching t-shirts. Mayor would like a few seconds.
I just want to also make a special presentation to Roy Huron and his wife Barbara and to Dr. Ben Carson and his wife Candy. And they will each be getting an official Crystal City coffee mug from the city, from the mayor's office and the city council, thanking you for what you've done for us at T.C. Williams and in Alexandria, Virginia.
So we're now going to have a formal ribbon cutting, so I would like to invite the superintendent, Mrs. Maxey, and our guests here to go and to cut the ribbon just outside the Carson room.